for the video audience. So dear God, we pray again, just we want to see your face. We want to be in your presence. We want to be like Moses on the mount when he saw your glory and he came down from the mount shining, beaming. He had the horns of light, the beams. He was beaming. He was reflecting your glory. Thank you, God. Just bring us into your presence, that we are also reflecting you here on the earth to other people. Thank you, God. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So, if you would turn with me, please, into the book of Isaiah 59. We will read the verse from here. And basically, we a little bit continue with the idea or the teaching that we had last Sunday. And it's about spirituality and being spiritual, or we could say even mature church. Not as a babes, but we are weaned from the milk. We are set apart from the milk and we are eating meat. That's a Serbian message, you know. Everybody eats meat in Serbia, so we go for maturity. So Isaiah 59, verse 19. This is very interesting. So it says here, speaking about the Gentiles and islands and like further places, and it says they will fear the name of the Lord from the west and his glory from the rising of the sun, which is east. And then it says here, and when the enemy shall come in like a flood, the Spirit of the Lord shall lift up a standard against him. So this is amazing. So when the enemy comes like a flood, you know, we spoke about this in Smederevo a little bit. Psalm 23, he leads me beside the still waters. And we spoke about this principle revealed in the scriptures, that many times the waters speak about some judgment. We know the judgment of the flood when God judged the world. We know the judgment of the Red Sea when God closed the waters and the Egyptians disappeared. Here is an enemy coming like a flood, which is basically invasion of other army or even other nation on Israel. And he says here now how he will protect Zion. And he says, so when the enemy shall come like a flood, the Spirit of the Lord shall lift up a standard against him. Now, what's this standard? You know, I don't know how to explain it in good way, but if you would see some battles from the Middle Ages, you know, you had basically two camps and every camp had certain standard, or we could say flag or a banner, and they were representing the standard, you know, and it's even until today. You can see this in a samurai movies, you can see it in a wars in America. You can see it in Europe. You know, every country has its own banner, standard. And you are basically under that standard. You are representing something. And here it says, so when the enemy comes, the Lord, the Spirit of the Lord, will lift up this standard. And what is this standard? In the Song of Solomon, when God speaks, and there's this picture of this relationship, this Shulamit woman, and in allegory representing us as the believers or the church and Christ. But Song of Solomon, let me read it here, chapter 2. Okay. And it says here, Song of Solomon, chapter 2, verse 4. And she's speaking about her beloved, and it says, and he brought me to the banqueting house, and his banner over me was love. So here's the expression, you know, this Shunammite woman speaks about herself, and she realizes her value and the care of her beloved. And she says, he brought me to the banqueting table. It's again Psalm 23. We said that he prepares the table for us inside of our enemies. And there's this feast. And the banner, the protection, the standard that God raises is love. And think about it this way. When the enemy comes like a flood, you know how flood comes? Sometimes you see a little bit, and then it comes suddenly from like nowhere. Sometimes it comes as a total surprise, you know, when the dam breaks or when the rain is really big in some area. It doesn't have to rain here, but it can rain in the mountains, and then the flood comes. So there may be even no sign of this coming. And then suddenly, this flood, this enemy comes. God raises the standard, the banner of love. He says, I love you. This is God's solution for all the problems. When somebody starts to attack you, God says, I love you. You are in this camp. You are not in the enemy's camp. You are not under this banner of a skull and you know, crossed bones. You are under the banner of love. And I am fighting for you. And I like this. Because this is what we need in these moments. In the moments like these. You know? And we lift up our voice. When the enemy comes like a flood, he says, I love you. This is his solution. Because we said it's the table. It's the fellowship. It's the feast. It's not necessarily the change of the situation. Because many times the situation will never change. And we can think even about the persecuted churches. And we will speak about it next Sunday because that's the International Day of Persecuted Churches. I think we will speak about persecution, about missions. And maybe even if you have something to say, experience from a mission field or, you know, first-hand testimony, like there'll be time for testimony. So pray if you, next Sunday, if you want to add something, you know, we can, everybody can take a part and just speak about it. So love is the solution when God says, I want you to know I love you. He brought me to the banqueting house, and his banner over me was love. In the face of enemy, we have a feast, and we enjoy this feast, and we know we are loved. I mean, I can make this picture in my mind. I think it's not totally proper, but imagine this like hill, and up on the hill, there's this table, and there is this romantic tent, you know, and it has this like white covering, you know, and the nice breeze is there and the candles, and you just like have this feast, while in the scenario behind you are these like evil enemies like rah, like running at you, but you are just feasting, you know. The enemy is running, the table is shaking like, but you are just like enjoying the fellowship. Because you know he loves you. And he will take care of them. That's amazing. To be so much in fellowship. That we don't care what they say. They may say things. The enemy. You know, enemy is not necessarily the one who has a sword. The enemy can be someone who has a tongue as a sword. And that's what we spoke, that it says, he leads me beside the still waters. When he quieteth the enemy. When he says, you be quiet, because I am having this feast and this fellowship. So his banner over us is this love. We are loved. And then it's easy to love our enemy, to give him grace and give him something he does not deserve, even to give him bread. You know, we don't often think this way, but we can see this in the Second Kings. Second Kings, chapter 6. There is a story of Elisha. And verse 18, it says, "And the enemy came down to him, and Elisha prayed unto the Lord and said, Smite these people, I pray you, with blindness. And God smote them with blindness according to the word of Elisha." So the whole army of enemies, they became blind. Now, the funny part is here, they are looking for Elisha and they want to catch him. So imagine, there is this special unit, you know, that is looking for Elisha. It's this like most trained unit, like some Spetsnaz, you know, or I don't know what kind of unit. And Elisha just prays and they don't see him. And then Elisha comes to them, to the people they want to catch him. And he says unto them, "This is not the way, neither is this the city. Follow me and I will bring you to the man whom you seek." So they are looking for him and he says, "Hey, you are going the wrong way and this is not the city, but follow me. I'll show you the man whom you seek," but he doesn't tell them, it's me. It's him. And he led them to Samaria. And it came to pass when they were come into Samaria that Elisha said, "Lord, now open the eyes of these men that they may see." And the Lord opened their eyes and they saw, and behold, they were in the midst of Samaria. So imagine the shock. They are looking for Elisha. They are supposed to capture him. But he leads them into a different city. And now they are in the midst of this Samaria. Their eyes are open and they know they are done. They just lost it completely. And the king of Israel says to Elisha, "My father, shall I smite them? Shall I smite them?" And Elisha answered, "You shall not smite them. Set the bread and water before them, that they may eat and drink, and then go to their master." You know, this is something we cannot understand naturally. There's an enemy who is seeking after your life. And God gives him into your hands. And Elisha says, "Don't kill him. You give him bread and water, and then send him home." It's very interesting. And you know, that's why it says in Galatians 5:22, the fruit of the Holy Spirit is love, joy, peace. Let's stop there. Love. The fruit of the Holy Spirit is love. You know, without the Holy Spirit, we cannot love. Because it's the fruit of the Spirit. How can I love my wife and my children and people that I am with? It's a spiritual thing. That's why we say we have to be spiritual. How can I love my enemy? Well, that's not possible, really. That's not possible. Loving enemy, and then another even worse one, loving your neighbor. You know, that's maybe even worse than enemy. But God says love. And now we see again, it's a spiritual thing. The king was thinking naturally, should I smite them? Should I smite them? Elisha says, no, you give them bread and water. We give them the provision for life. We give them the word. We give them bread and water. We give them the word and then send them home. And you know what? The enemy is ashamed. They went home ashamed. And then it says here, so they ate and drank, and he sent them away, and they went to their master. So the bands of Syria came no more into the land of Israel. Because these people, these soldiers, they knew, like, why should we go and fight against them? When we are evil, they are good toward us. And they were like so broken by this and so ashamed. I remember the moment when we were with this group once, you know, and we loved this group. You know, it was like a small group of like believers. And we bake a cake for them while they said we should not come anymore into their group. And it was, you know, it was so bittersweet on one hand. Like, we had the tears in our heart because we were ministering them the grace and love, and they basically turned against it. But there was this moment when Eva made this cake, and they told us that day, they said, we don't want you anymore. And I remember we just opened the cake and we said, look, what Eva did, there's a cake for you. Take a piece. Take a piece of cake. They were like, but we don't want you here. He said, okay, just take a piece. I mean, you decided, but, you know. And they were so ashamed. I remember that till today. And this is nothing comparing to how they will be ashamed before God. Love your enemy. And you know what? When we are filled with the Spirit, Galatians 5:22, the fruit of the Spirit is love. It's a supernatural. We cannot produce it. It has to be God through us. But when this happens, you don't have a nightmares after these bad experiences. Because you are at the banqueting table. The banner over you is love. You are loving even your enemy. I remember there was this story of Sabina Wumbrand. She was a Romanian. She was a wife of one pastor in Romania, Richard Wumbrand. And there was this moment when... No, it was actually Richard Wumbrand. He was in the prison. And the prison guards, they were beating them every time when they prayed. Because they were communists and they hated this, like, religious behavior. And the prisoner came to him and he said, why are you still praying? Because you are in prison, your wife Sabina is in prison, your son is homeless now, you don't even know where he is. What are you praying to? Like, what are you thanking God for? And you know, he looked at him and he said, I was just praying for you. And in that moment, the enemy, the one who was supposed to beat him for the prayers, he just went away, ashamed. He was attacking his spiritual life. And Wumbrand said, I was praying for you. This is so powerful. This is so great. And 1 Peter 4:8, it says, and above all things, have fervent charity among yourselves, for charity shall cover the multitude of sins. Charity, love. Above all things, have love. Above all. Above everything. What's the problem? Tell me something. What's the problem? Put it here on the table. Above all, above everything, have love. This is supernatural. When you have a problem, somebody step on your toe. Above this, have love. If we love one another, it's much easier to say, oh, it's okay. It hurts, of course, but I love you. I love you. We don't see it anymore as something unpleasurable. It's like my son who is running at me in the morning and he jumps at me and he hits me with his knees into my ribs. and we fell on the floor, you know. And I love him, that's why I don't mind. Because the love is above all. Does it hurt? I can't still breathe until today, you know. But I love him. You see how it changes the perspective? Above all, have love. But where do I take this love? Nobody taught me how to love. I thought my parents did, and they did a great job, but it's still limited. Because they gave some limits on love, you know. They taught me how to put limits. But God has unlimited love. I remember Pastor Stevens was teaching once, and somebody came to him and they said, "Don't you see that the people are like walking over you? You know, that they are just using you as a doormat?" And you know what he said? He said, "I know. I don't mind. It's okay. They can use me. I don't mind. Because it's not personal. It's not me. It's about Christ. I'm not fighting my ground. On the other hand, yes, we are fighting for things. The doctrine. You know, we are fighting against the evil. We want to keep the purity of faith. You know, we are addressing false teaching, definitely, because this is our bread and water. You know, we are protecting the young ones, children, teenagers, older people. You know, we will fight for them. But as touching me, if somebody walks over me, I don't care. Really, I don't care. Because this is God's battle. And in the midst of this situation, I am having a beautiful feast. And you know what? Shame on you. Shame on you. And they will be ashamed by our goodness. And it says here, "By doing this, you shall heap up hot coals on his head," or condemnation. Loving, I think it's Proverbs 25, maybe. Loving your enemy. Let me just see it. Proverbs, if I have it right, 25, verse 21. Yeah, "If your enemy be hungry, give him bread to eat. If he be thirsty, give him water to drink. For thou shalt heap coals of fire upon his head, and the Lord shall reward thee." This is something which you, neither me, can do naturally. We need God. This is why I said we need to be spirit-filled. You know, we cannot just speak about love of God. We cannot speak about gifts of God or of the Spirit, as we are teaching in the book of Romans. It's of the Spirit. We need to be Spirit-filled, and we are. Now, and we mentioned many times, somebody will say, "Well, this love message is so cheap." Really? It's strong as death. Again, Song of Solomon, chapter 8, verse 6. It's strong as death. What it means? People will give their life. They will even die if they are filled with love. It's so strong, which means it's unstoppable. Nothing will stop them. What has stopped Jesus Christ from coming down on earth? The love motivated him, and nobody was able to stop him. He gave his life for us. What about the other missionaries? You know, Pastor Steve DeVries, he was my teacher in the Bible school. He was teaching Pauline epistles. He was on a mission field in South Korea for some time. Maybe he's still there, I don't know. And he said that they sometimes made the trips to the Chinese border, which is bordering with Northern Korea. And they said what happens there, that these North Korean people, it's It's a totalitarian, totalitarian. There's totality. You know, there is a tyranny. That's true underworld. So this system doesn't allow people like nothing. So what happens when some believers, they find Christ in that country? They cross the borders and they risk their lives and they run into China. And he said what happens many times. There are missionaries on the borders of China waiting for them. And they come and they start to teach them Bible. And as they teach them, many of these people will realize, now I have to go back. Because who else will tell them? You cannot go. You are white. You are European. You are American. You are Serbian. You are Czech. You look different. But I am from there, and I know it, and I have relatives and friends. And they go back to bring the gospel. And then many times, nobody hears about them anymore. Love is strong as death. People will give their lives. This is what we want. Above all is the love of God, 1 Peter. Above all, 1 Peter 4:8. Above all is the love of God. If we keep this in our heart, where are the problems? In the relationships, in the church problems. Well, should we have blue curtains or white ones, you know? And there's a church split. And then you have two churches. One church has blue curtains and another one has white curtains. That's why we have red curtains. No, just joking. But that's the thing. Where is the love as a consuming fire? And then, God loved, John 3:16, God so loved that he gave. When we love, it's easy to give. In the relationships, everywhere. When we love, it's easy to give, even your life. Now, we can go and we can make this progress. We can say, no loving, no giving. If I don't love, why would I care? Then we can go and say, much loving, much giving. It's better, right? Or we could say even big loving, big giving. Or we could say, all loving, all giving. And this is the agape. We love with God's love, all. And then we are able to give all we have and all who we are. There is no limit on God's love. Many waters cannot quench the love. Neither can floods drown it. Again, Song of Solomon, chapter 8, verse 7. Song of Solomon, 8, 7. She says, many waters cannot quench the love. We spoke about this is the type of the waters, the flood, the enemy, the judgment, the talk, the condemnation. You know what? When love is there, many waters cannot quench love. People will tell you bad things about Jesus, but it cannot quench your love. And the flood, they cannot drown it. Because it's in your heart, it's different. We don't buy this stuff, we don't listen to it. These words of condemnation and judgment. And you will hear things about you. People will be speaking about you. People are speaking about us all the time. But what we have, the banqueting table. These floods cannot quench the love we have, the fellowship with Jesus Christ. It cannot be quenched. And then it says, 1 John 4:17, there is no fear in love. In this is our love made perfect, that we may have boldness in the day of judgment. You see, it's all connected to quieting the voices. And the judgment, the day of judgment, we will not be judged. Because Christ was judged in our stead on the cross. This is the beauty, and it says, in love there is no fear. When we are with Him, we have no fear. Love is not afraid. Or you could say, love is not afraid, love is unafraid. Love is unafraid. That's why we go and minister. And that's why we will go to North Korea. Let's send somebody to North Korea this year. Not me. Somebody else. You know, and if, no. If God lead us, we will do it, right? I was just joking. This is extreme, you know. This is extreme missions. That's like one way and never coming back, maybe. But in God's time. Love is unafraid, and we love because we are loved. We love because we are loved. 1 John 4:19, we love Him because He first loved us. This is it. This is the point. You remember the old booklet, Just Let God Love Me? Just Let God Love You. Sorry, Just Let God Love You. You know? We just let God to love us, and He will do it. When we understand this. In John chapter 12, you know this story very well, but I want to point out the key verse from this passage. John chapter 12, verse 3. This is where we start. There is a Jesus. They are sitting in a house of Lazarus. And verse 3 it says, and then took Mary a pound of ointment, very costly, and anointed the feet of Jesus and wiped His feet with her hair. And the house was filled with the odor of the ointment. Then said one of His disciples, Judas Iscariot, Simon's son, which should betray Him. He said in verse 5, why was not this ointment sold for 300 pence and given to the poor? And He said it not because He cared for the poor, but because He was a thief and He had the bag with the money. And verse 7, this is the crown of these verses. Then said Jesus, let her alone. Let her alone. Shut up. Keep quiet. He is quieting the waters, the voices, different voices which are coming at us. Here is a woman which is performing this service on the body of Jesus Christ. In modern days, somebody who is helping the church, the body of Jesus Christ, and people will murmur and they will be talking about it. And Jesus says, if we sit at His feet, Jesus quiets the voices and He says, let her alone. This is how God fights for us. And He will. You know, when something happens to David, he runs to me. And I go there. And I say to this little enemy, let him alone. I am his father. Me, David, friends. Me, you, friends. Then you, David, friends. Okay? This is how I speak with my broken Serbian. If you want to be friend with me, you got to be friend with David. I quieted him. And you know what? Now he's waving at David, waving at me. We are great friends. You know? So, this is how God fights the battles. He quiets the voices. And the banner is, when the flood comes, when the enemy attacks, he says, I love you, I love you, I love you. Just know that I love you. This is the banner. Let's have a feast in the midst of this situation. And then don't get me wrong. Many times God will change the situation. But sometimes He is there just with us, and we enjoy his presence in the midst of this situation. And you know, when the devil wants to do something bad to you, when he wants to get you out of God's plan, God's will, you know what he will do? He will attack places in your life that it hurts. Some spots in your life when it hurts a lot. He will attack your children. How it hurts. God, it hurts. No, the devil hurts. Because he is the liar from beginning. John chapter 8. He is a murderer. And he's a liar. He doesn't bring anything good. And that's why Bible says, love not the world, neither things therein. You know, when we understand his character, how evil he is, you don't love the world. Because you know it's wicked and it's sick. And it hurts people. That's why there are so many divorces, alcoholism, and other things. You know, families which are ripped apart. I mean, we see it daily. You know, we are meeting these people. And some of those people are even Christians. And their lives are ripped apart. But we don't love the world because we know it's rotten. And 2 Samuel chapter 3. Now you will see the beauty of this passage. 2 Samuel chapter 3. There is a story of David. David is anointed king. He is supposed to have a rule over the kingdom, which he does not have completely, because Saul is ruling. Now, the king Saul dies, but his sons are ruling in his stead. So David doesn't have a full kingdom yet. And then what happens, there is this Abner, which comes to David, and he says, I will give you the kingdom. He just changed the mind, and he said, you know, now from serving the house of Saul, I will come to you and I will serve the house of David. And genuinely, he has these real motives, genuine motives. And he brings the kingdom to David. But then what happens? Joab kills him. So Joab kills this Abner who brought the kingdom to David. Joab is a guy who works with David. He is the head of his armies. Although David said, don't do it. You know, Joab was so angry and he went and killed him. And verse 39, 2 Samuel chapter 3, verse 39. Watch this. David says, and I am this day weak. You know, there will be days when you will be weak. There will be days when you will be weak. Things will happen. And here he was betrayed by his general. He trusted him. And this general went and murdered his friend. And David says, I was betrayed and I'm weak. And he says this, though I am anointed king. This is the solution. When you know that you have been anointed, that God has a plan, God gave it to you. I know that the situation doesn't look like. I know that your friend betrays you and murders your another friend. I know you are weak right now. But you know this one thing. You are anointed. God has not left you. God has a plan for your life. And then he adds and he says, and these men, the sons of Zeruiah, that's these sons, that's this Joab, Abishai and Asahel. Basically, these were the sons of David's sister, David's nephews. And he says, and these, they are too hard for me. So now David is in the situation when he is supposed to have the kingdom and he does not have it. Now he has these friends around him, which basically are doing their own things and hurting the purpose of God and the purpose of David. Because David wants to do something and they do things on their own. And David is devastated. And he says, I'm weak, but I know I'm anointed king. Just know this, that when people go wrong way, when people do bad things, and it even hurts the kingdom, you just sit and you may say, I am weak, I don't have the strength and energy, I've tried so much, but I know this one thing, I am anointed. It means God has chosen this plan and he will lead me through. And it says here, verse 36 is before, and all the people took notice of it and it pleased them. And whatsoever the king did pleased all the people. The situation is that all Israel thought that David sent Joab to murder his friend. But then when they saw David, they realized it was not so. And the people loved David. And I'm just saying this because you can see here. David has this plan. David is taking over the kingdom. But his friends do these like murders. And it gives a bad light on him in front of his people, in front of the Israel. Now whole Israel thinks David sent Joab to murder his friend. But then when they saw David, they realized this was not work of David. They loved what David is doing. You know, don't worry if people do a murder of your character. Can you say this? Or assassination of your character. When people speak evil and bad about you, when people do their own things and they hurt you, there is a church, there is a certain vision, and other people, they do their own things, but it's a hurt to the church. You know what? You just stand in this fact. I'm weak. It hurts me, but I am anointed because God sent me. We are anointed. We know what we are doing. And it says here, the common people heard him gladly. The common people will know. The common people will understand that you are God's anointed. And this, what's going around, it will not put a, I don't know how to say it, black marks on you. You know, you will come out pure from this. Common people will understand. Common people will understand. And then, as we said, we love them. We can't do it out of our own strength. But God can do it. We are loved. That's why we love. You know, let's be just open to God and say, God, love me. Love me this week, love me this year. I want to be so loved that it's easy for me to love others. And by this, and that's not why we do it, but by this, we put them to shame. So remember, next time when you have an enemy, bake a cake for him. Just offer him a cake out of pure love, because that's what happened in that moment. You should see the faces. They so much didn't want to take it, but they took it, and the loved expression was such a shame for them as they were eating this cake while they said, don't come anymore. God is great. We may be weak at the moments, but we know we are anointed. So let's be spirit-filled, because love is the fruit of the Spirit, Galatians 5:22. God bless you. Amen.